This evening, we want to take up another phase of the problem of the invisible forces around us and within us that can and do affect our more ordinary lives. We have all seen in religious art representations of sanctified persons around whose heads are halos, and we realize that from a very early time, the nimbus, the aureole, and the halo have been used to indicate some kind of spiritual emanation flowing from the bodies of very highly spiritualized, highly regenerated beings. While this artistry is reasonably common in the West, it has probably been developed into a more advanced concept among Eastern peoples. I suppose there is no artistry in the world that makes as much of these radiant fields surrounding the human body as Buddhism, especially in Japan. Here we can analyze and study many types of halo, and we discover that these different types are associated with varying degrees of spiritual progress, that it is possible to consider them as a more or less exact symbolic language. And many of the designs and ornamentations are very beautiful and wonderfully intricate in their development. The whole concept undoubtedly rises from the belief among ancient peoples that the life force within the human being does radiate out from the body and does surround it with what 19th century mesmerists in Europe referred to as an invisible perspiration, a kind of constant emanation of force, a luminous fur-like radiance. It is possible to exaggerate this by means of high-frequency electricity so that these fields can actually be photographed. Dr. Kilner, in his researches in the hospital in Liverpool, developed his screens by means of which the disease could be diagnosed from the emanation fields of the human body. Paracelsus wrote of them. The Greeks and Latins recorded fables about these mysterious spheres of light within which living creatures moved and existed. We have had a tendency in more recent time to ignore this entire problem, although actually, when confronted with reasonable thinking, we are forced to admit that in all probability, these energy fields do exist. Even the modern scientist is inclined to regard this matter rather sympathetically. He is quite convinced that man is a center of energy, and there seems no reason to doubt that this energy radiates, just as energy will radiate from an electrical device of one kind or another. We have not, however, given much thought to the development of science bearing on this theme. We have assumed that if it exists at all, it is simply part of man's manifold Constitution. And this is, of course, the basic viewpoint, but perhaps if these energies were more visible to more people, we would already have considered them in many of the forms of science and medicine which we have gradually developed. Psychology took hold of a phase of this, and we have a more or less integrated realization that man does develop mysterious vibratory patterns within himself, which may be called complexes. A complex we think of as a fixation or a highly fixed attitude within the individual. Yet underneath everything else, a complex has to be energy. It has to have some kind of a vibratory existence. It has to be a vibratory thing in order to have any power to communicate itself, or to sustain itself, or to continue its own patterns or consistencies. Unless a thing is constantly nourished in some way, it must fade out or disappear. And complexes have a tendency to build rather than to fade. And we assume now that we are constantly vitalizing them with our own attitudes. What are our attitudes? Attitudes have to be energy. They have to be vibration. And if a complex is fed by attitude, it means that it is nourished by energy. It is sustained by a certain conditioned kind of vibration. Now, what conditions vibration? Why is one vibration different from another? Paracelsus took the attitude that man is capable of influencing vibration by thought. That actually, therefore, human emotions and human mental attitudes really become the creators, or become molders of energy. A constructive thought has a rate of vibration of its own. A destructive thought has a rate of vibration. If, therefore, the individual thinks constructively, he supports in constructive ways the energy field of his own body. We are inclined to suspect, therefore, that health has a great deal to do with mental attitude. We know this, we accept it, we affirm it, but we do not try to explain how it operates. We do not know what the relationship is between a good thought and a healthy body. We assume that bad thinking interferes with function, that it depresses, that it makes the nature gloomy. What is the difference between a cheerful and a gloomy disposition? The only possible answer to it is a difference of vibration. That in one case, a certain rate of vibration conveys the impression or carries the energy of a constructive attitude, whereas another carries the energy of a destructive attitude. It was the opinion of the medievals that destructive attitudes created monsters. We don't follow this exactly anymore, but perhaps this is the real mystery of demonism. Perhaps the demon is a thought form. Perhaps it is an emotional intensity form. Something that has a life imparted to it, sustained by the constant support of our own attitudes. In any event, psychology has come up with the notion that what we used to think of bewitchment was really a problem of fixation, of complexes, of attitudes that became obsessional by constant repetition. to be obsessional, an attitude must exercise a powerful influence. To have an influence, it must have energy. And the moral quality of the influence will be determined by the moral quality of the vibration which this particular pattern sets up in the compound nature of ourselves. We also can notice this in other ways. One of the simplest ways of studying vibration, of course, is through some simple form as the snowflake or the frost pictures on a window pane. These pictures and the forms in the snow crystals show that form or structure crystallizes around energy. Now we think of forms as all of them visible forms. We haven't really gotten to the point where we have accepted the reality of invisible structures in nature. Again, however, if we sit down a little and think it through, we realize that they have to exist. If it were not for invisible structures, visible ones could not come into being. For what we call a visible form must in some way arise from archetype. There has to be some reason why things take on certain appearances. Lavater, the great French physiognomist, used the human face as a symbol of the constant mutation of attitudes and their effect upon the body. He pointed out that the human face is constantly changing in expressions, and that these expressions arise from moods, and these moods in turn move out from within the individual as a result of some stimuli which create in him pleasure or displeasure, happiness or misery, friendliness or hatred. But whatever our moods may be, unless we are very skillful in concealing them, they move into almost immediate expression in our appearance. When we are happy, the face brightens, the smile appears. When we are sad, the smile disappears, and a heavy, weary, tiresome look attacks our features. Thus our physical body, especially the face, is forever bearing witness to the internal pressures of our lives, and by the sensitive instrumentality of the nervous system, the vibrations inside of ourselves are communicated to a language of reflexes which creates visible patterns in our features and may also affect the posture of the body, causing us to gesticulate or to take on some curious mannerism. In the same general way, then, we have come through the ages to take it for granted that each person is like a kind of an alchemical bottle containing within himself the compound of his own nature in the form of an energy formula. This energy formula is made up of all of his attitudes, all of his feelings and opinions, all his beliefs and disbeliefs. And because the substance of this mysterious energy field is exceedingly fluidic or volatile, it can change very much more rapidly than the body. Therefore, actually, our moods can change almost instantaneously. And we are capable of causing an almost constant commotion within this mysterious alchemical vessel which contains the energies of our lives. Thus, in one moment, this vessel may seem to become radiant with a magnificent, luminous quality. And in the next moment, it may seem to be strangely dark and dull and poisonous looking, all depending upon our own moods. Now, we have always had the feeling that moods were things we were entitled to. After all, we can put on a good front to other people But we certainly are entitled to have private miseries when we feel like it. If we don't like someone, we may not permit our feelings to be obvious, but it would seem to be a terrible deprivation indeed if we were forbidden a secret animosity when it seems that the occasion justifies. But we do have to realize that there are no secrets in the universe, finally. We can hide things from each other, but we cannot hide completely the mysterious vibratory patterns of our natures. Whether we can see them or not, these patterns exist. Whether we know it or not, these patterns affect us. And they also affect our relationship with other people. They affect us in our relationships with ourselves. So let us imagine for a moment that the average person is surrounded by and existing in a private smog belt. This smog belt is much more difficult and perhaps more dangerous than the smog-ridden atmosphere of our fair city. This smog belt is the result of the pollution of our psychic atmosphere. It means that we are constantly pouring into the etheric field of the body more negation than can be properly neutralized by the operations of universal energy circulation. We are expected to cast off constantly into the magnetic field certain refuse from the body. Also, certain exhausted psychic energies are cast off. And with these, in turn, a fair number of negative vibratory impulses. We are therefore able, as modern science fully realizes, to be unpleasant to a certain degree and still apparently not suffer too much as a result. We can have an angry spell once a year or once in several years, and on rare occasions what we term an outburst of righteous indignation, and we probably will not have anything worse than a headache or a stomachache or something of that nature. The body is able to neutralize a considerable amount of negation, even a measure of viciousness. But when it goes too far, when there is too much of a certain quality of destructive energy or destructive thought or destructive emotion, then the magnetic field becomes polluted. When this happens, the person is deprived of a large part of his natural energy resource. He becomes psychically toxic. Now, a psychic toxin is not so different in many ways from a physical one. Both are rates of vibration. But the psychic toxin affects us in our psychic natures, causing attitudes to become increasingly negative and destroying within us the psychic integration that is necessary for normalcy. If, therefore, physical toxins can sicken the body and bring with them, in time, physical disease, psychic toxins can sicken the mind and sicken the emotions, and will, if continued, bring on disease in these regions, causing us to be mentally or emotionally sick. And this can be more difficult and more terrible for us than any physical ailment which we may be forced to endure. It's also interesting to realize that our ancient forebears did not limit this magnetic field situation to man or even to the animals. Experiments, of course, have indicated that it is possible to become aware of the magnetic fields of plants, also of minerals, and that certain gems and stones have very powerful magnetic influence. Paracelsus conceived the possibility of a great magnetic medicine based upon all types of metallurgical compounds and various chemicals and drugs, and also to him what we call the vitamin theory was associated with the magnetic and energy fields of living things. In other words, we live, our nutrition is derived not from the bodies of our food elements, but from the energies of them, the vibrations that are locked within the physical food elements themselves. This is why, in many instances, vibration is reduced or even destroyed by cooking or by having food stand too long until separated from their sources of life, deterioration and decay set in, when they are no longer serviceable to us as was intended. In any event, we can go still further, for the ancients carried the conviction within themselves that there were many different forms of vibration that could be of value or important to us. Pythagoras pointed out that forms, shapes, patterns, designs, dimensions, all have vibratory factors. That the vibration of a cube is different from that of a sphere. And while it is hard for us to realize that such a thing could be true, he was convinced that all forms in nature can only remain as forms because the minute particles that hold these forms together are themselves a living energy. And that therefore these energy elements cause all things, what we call animate or inanimate, to be actually and ultimately alive. Our ancient forebears also were deeply impressed with the aliveness of music. They held definitely that all great musical compositions, all great musical modes, created vibratory patterns in the atmosphere or in the energy fields of nature. That music set up vibrations in space, that these vibrations had forms, and these forms united in great symbolic patterns that the music sounds, the symphonies, the oratorios, the sonatas, and all these things created distinct patterns. That some of these patterns rose like magnificent unfolding flowers in space. Others burst forth in countless designs resembling snowflakes and things of this nature. But everywhere sound produced color and form, and then also locked within it number or mathematical relationships and ratios. That these patterns of vibrations developed like the principle of the octave mathematically. That octaves exist not only in sound, but in color, in elements, and even in the divisions of races and clans and species of living things. Everything in nature was a vast, interrelated, vibratory mystery. Man, in his relationship to these other things, might or might not be aware of this. He might have the power to see some of these forms. He might be able to see a high mass in a great cathedral unfolding its majesty. He might also suddenly be aware that in a strange way the inspired, perhaps initiated artisans who had created the cathedral had actually captured in the very form of the building a tremendous musical chord, and that the building rose in its spans and arches very much like the music that filled it when some great choral was being produced. These things the ancients sensed or knew. They also realized that whether we can see these different forms or not, we can experience them to some degree. We experience them in many ways that we do not even realize. We know, for example, that human relationships are extremely complicated things, that beneath the common meetings and minglings of people, there are strange pressures, antagonisms, antipathies, that some are drawn mysteriously together, others are violently separated by moods within their own natures. Some people can work together, others cannot. Some can live together, others find such relationships gradually more and more unendurable. We are constantly also aware of our instinctive suspicions of some people. How the very moment we meet them, we seem to sense there's something wrong. And there are others, almost strangers, for whom we immediately develop a powerful and unexplainable sympathy. All these mysterious examples of psychic chemistry have to be explained by vibration. They have to be part of this mysterious, invisible chemistry of energies in which these chemistries meet and mingle, unite and separate, and maintain a strange, enduring individuality among themselves, even though they may seem to coalesce and actually become one. The ancients had quite a concept of all of this, a sort of invisible chemistry that was something like their alchemy or their divine chemistry, the chemistry of living things rather than the chemistry of physical elements as we have come to think of them in modern chemistry. It has not occurred to us that the struggling elements in the test tube might be in mortal agony. It hasn't occurred to us that any of these strange processes which we see taking place around us might arise from the mixtures of energies, of loves and hates, of fears and hopes, expressed through symbols and patterns which we cannot really tune into. We can only somehow sense their existence. Psychology has given us a certain concept of this, although perhaps an inadequate one up to the present time. It has pointed out, however, definitely that the individual has an internal in which patterns can be set up, that this internal is a sort of room or laboratory where experimentation is constantly taking place. And into this subjective area of our experience, there's constantly flowing the conditioned energies of our attitudes. Here these energies have their own existence, form their own patterns, survive in their own ways, and in many instances complicate our lives and our ways of thinking and living. One other point that may be of interest to bring in is to remind students of the practices of yoga and the great universe of invisible energies that we find discussed and analyzed in the great early texts of yoga, tantra, and Vedanta. Here we have an invisible world of qualities. This world of qualities has something to do with the redemption of man. And what is this redemption in the terms of Tantra, for example? It is the individual redeeming his own magnetic field. It is the individual purifying his own inner life, performing the mysterious labors of some mystical Hercules. It is this cleansing of the inner life by the setting up, by scientific means, philosophical science or esoteric science, of patterns which neutralize destructive energy fields within the human body. This also, to a large degree, is the true explanation behind Buddhist philosophy for the the entire struggle of Buddhism to achieve emancipation, to free the individual from the pressures of ignorance and superstition and fear within himself. These philosophic disciplines have as their purpose the purification, the quieting, the calming of the struggle of energies within the vibration nature of the highly confused person. Now, from these studies, we come to some things that are perhaps a little more practical to our present thinking. Let us assume, for example, that an individual has lived what we would term a reasonable life. That is, he has lived within the prescribed area of normalcy. He hasn't been reasonable very often, but he has a fair reputation for it. He is good-intentioned, he is kindly disposed, he's no better than he should be, and no worse than those around him. Therefore, he is regarded as highly normal. This situation means that within him is a mass of conflict and confusion, not as bad as it is in some person who is obviously unable to take care of himself. But the so-called average person of today is not internally truly at peace with himself. The vibratory field of his body is made up of miscellaneous energy pressures. Perhaps he has no great outstanding pattern. There is no real energy design which he is building up purposefully. He hasn't a structure so firmly established within himself that all external attitude is contributing something to it. He has a willy-nilly internal which is supported by the inconsistencies of his external life. He would like to do well, he would like to be kind, he wants to be a person of responsibility, but he has no real dramatic insight. He has no tremendous conviction that is leading him towards any particular well-established point or place or condition for himself. This individual has, for instance, some intemperance. He becomes fanatical rather easily. He has strong inclinations politically or socially. He quickly becomes angry, easily jealous, envious upon occasion. Then he is also good-hearted, generous, kind to animals, perhaps more so than to people. But whatever it is, he has the nice side to himself. Supports all recognized charities. He tries to turn in a fair day's work for his wages. Whatever it is, he is just a person. This individual has, therefore, a certain energy resource. He builds up an archetype, whether he knows it or not. This archetype must have a form, it must have a color, it must have a rate of vibration, it must have all of the attributes of living things, because it is a living thing. It is really much more a living thing than his body is. Because whereas the body receives energy by second hand, this energy thing itself at least is supported by a first-hand energy, very close to and immediate to itself. This individual has some kind of a desire to improve, to become a better person. So he begins to set in motion, we'll say, religious instincts. And these religious instincts are of a higher rate of vibration than the energy instincts and appetites with which he is most familiar. If he has a reasonably normal outlook on life, he grows a little better. And the energies that he is now sustaining gradually raise the vibratory rate of his inner life. If, however, he becomes too enthusiastic, if he becomes a little fanatical in his quest for spiritual values, he may create a serious conflict in his nature. Buddhism points this out very clearly, that you cannot be the old self and the new self at the same time. Bhimi describes it, the German mystic describes it, as not being able to be the old Adam and the new Adam at the same time. That if there is too great an inconsistency between our habits, our attitudes, and our convictions, there will be stress. And this stress is liable to endanger our mental and emotional poise. Just as surely as it is difficult for us to live with unpleasant situations around us in family or in business, so it is difficult for the internal person to live in a situation in which parts of its nature are torn in one direction and parts in another. When the psychic field is required to have two allegiances, and these allegiances are not compatible, then there is trouble. So it is quite possible that the person who tries to unfold too rapidly the higher vibratory rates of his nature will get into trouble, because these higher vibrations will come into violent conflict with other vibrations that are not so high and not so redeemed in their quality. The person may therefore come not to enlightenment but to sickness. He will find that the vibratory energies that he is developing are too much for his mental focal point. His mind is on one level of energy, he is trying to spiritualize it, and this spiritualizing force is like sending too much current over a wire. It will burn out the circuit. He may find that his emotional ideals are very lofty, but his emotional practices are rather earthy. And here again, the conflict means that the body, the psychic organism as we know it, is not able to sustain the exceptional energies that are cast upon it by some resolution of the will. It is therefore, as Buddha points out, very important that the individual first of all clears the mental, emotional, vibratory field. That before he attempts to put high vibrations into this area, that the vibrations which would be in conflict with it must be cleared by the person himself. He must, therefore, have a house cleaning before he dedicates his life to some nobler pursuit. He cannot try to grow spiritually and nurse all his old faults and failings. He cannot keep on hating and at the same time develop a powerful, constructive regard for deity. He cannot have a deep mystical experience while jealousies and self-centeredness constantly build up negative areas within his own consciousness. If he tries to fight the thing out inside of himself, he breaks the basic rules of Zen and Taoism. He breaks the whole concept of discipline as it was set up by the ancient initiate teachers. Well, the purpose of discipline is always purification. The individual in the Platonic and Neoplatonic concepts must first attain a certain catharsis. He must dispose of that which is unworthy in himself. If he does not, he will create a situation of combustion in which he will neither be the same person he was before, with the reasonable adjustment that made life endurable, if not truly enriched and purposeful, nor will he be able to suddenly rise to some great heights of achievement without regard for the fact that the negative vibratory pressures of his attitudes are holding him down. He cannot pull apart. He cannot separate himself. And if he tries to force such a separation, then he is very apt to develop a multiple personality problem and become a psychotic. So that the study of these energy fields and their resources and their contributions to the total picture, this study is at least theoretically highly rewarding. It has to do with many values that are important to us. The ancients referred to the magic mirror, and the medieval transcendentalists, those of the early modern French school, spoke of the mystery of the astral light. And this is the same thought that we find in the opera of Parsifal, where Klingsor's magic garden is the symbol of a strange world of fantasy and illusion, a world filled with beautiful flowers. Around the stem of every flower coiled a deadly serpent. This mysterious world of the astral light has also come down to us in psychology. This mysterious mirror of the sun goddess Amaterasu is preserved for us in the entire mystery of psychic phenomena. So we have to pause here for a moment and give this thought a little consideration. Suppose we say that this mysterious, magnetic, luminous sphere that surrounds man is this magic mirror. That in this magic mirror, man has a strange, unreal, but apparent sovereignty. That this magic mirror is something like the confused legendary of a Midsummer Night's Dream. Here in this magic mirror is a world that has no reality at all, but it is anything we want it to be, anything we believe it to be. This magic mirror, this astral light, was so-called the blind alley of the ancient mystics. It was this problem of constant danger of self-delusion. It was a condition in which the mysterious power of mind and emotion to create pictures, patterns, designs, this power somewhat like the strange fantasies of sleep by which the psychic pressures of our natures can fill our sleeping experience with dreams and nightmares and strange, vague incidents. This magic mirror within man was not only a problem of visualization, of seeing things, it was a problem of convictions about things. And the simplest explanation that we have of it is that it enables any individual to believe what he wants to believe, experience what he demands to experience, see what he expects to see, and hear that which he intends to hear. This mysterious energy of illusion, having no substance in itself, fashions all things into the likeness of our hopes and our fears and our beliefs. If we are fearful enough, this mirror suddenly clouds with demoniacal forms, and we can see in this mirror the whole miserable form of hell. If we want to, we can see in this mirror the reflection of ourselves, any self we wish to see reflected there. The egotist sees all the vainglory of his own estimation of himself. The wretched see their own wretchedness. The ambitious see the full fruitage of their ambitions. Those who believe in life see life. Those who believe in death see death. Those who believe in anything of any kind can, from the subtle substances of their own imaginings, form justifications for their beliefs. Now, the social implication of this is especially interesting today, for never before, probably, in our history, have more people been seeing, sensing, believing, or affirming a wider variety of experiences. You hardly meet anyone today who has not dramatic opinions on almost every issue that exists. He never speaks as having opinions. He always speaks of certainties. Everything that we believe is terribly real. And our beliefs are not only fantastically intense, but they shift and change with every passing policy of time. We can be as dogmatic about one subject one day as we were on an entirely different subject the preceding day. We, however, are always sure, we always seem to have the tremendous support of our total nature behind every attitude that we hold, regardless of how absurd or unreasonable it may be. All this terrible attitudinarianism, this tremendous pressure of the irresistibility of our own impulse arises in vibration. And it arises from this mysterious power of energy within ourselves to take upon its own qualities the absolute appearances that we demand of it. This energy is chameleon-like in changing its color constantly. It is Proteus-like in presenting a thousand faces. Whatever we demand, expect, require, it is there. And for the person himself, it seems completely valid, absolutely certain, undeniably real. As this situation goes along, we know that it produces all over the world an infinite conflict. Children cannot agree with their parents anymore. Parents cannot agree between themselves. Nations have no common ground. Every law that is passed offends some and is applauded by others. There is no common agreement as to virtue, integrity, beauty, truth, or wisdom. Each individual or group, sustained by its own strange archetypal intensity, demands that the universe take on the likeness of its own purpose. And in the magic mirror of things, the universe seems to do so. We look into the depths of this mirror, and we see God or no God, according to our own attitude. We see the likeness of deity as personal principle or energy or power, exactly what we demand to see there. This mirror is nothing but our own attitude reflected back, what it seems to present to us, a tremendous cosmic reality. Now, this mirror, this strange magic mirror, is always clouded by the shapes and appearances of undisciplined intensities. This is why the ancients warned man long ago that each individual had to develop a center of integrity. He had to develop a basic philosophy of life, a pattern of realities that could not be shaken by opinion. He had to have some real and great conviction, a conviction arising in some truth superior to his own thinking. It was only when he was able to discipline his own mind and emotion that he could prevent the shadows from gathering on the magic mirror. The disciplined person will not demand the impossible. Therefore, he will not see the impossible reflected back upon him as a possibility. He will not expect the unreasonable. He will not populate space with false forms or life with false values. And because his own core is not deceived, he will never deceive himself. Self-deceit arises from lack of self-discipline. The individual who has no foundation in values can move from one attitude to another without even the sense of inconsistency. He can live in a strange dream world, and every different dream is a reality. Having no core, having no reality in himself, he is unable to escape the pressure of the common illusion. That is why most ancient mystics, most ancient religious and philosophic groups required of their disciples these periods of purification, this gradual sublimation of intensity. The ancient Oriental mystics taught the individual that while selfishness existed within himself, self-delusion was inevitable. While hate or jealousy or grievances were in himself, truth simply could not exist in him. But no matter how much he learned, he would still deceive himself. No matter how beautiful the doctrines were that he studied, he would gradually corrupt them to meet his own personal prejudices. Or else he would try desperately to be two people. He would try to nurse his prejudices on the one hand and cling to his principles on the other. Out of this would come greater confusion, and usually physical or emotional sickness. So in this mysterious vibratory pattern in which we live, the vibrations of our attitudes paint pictures. They create all kinds of appearances and likenesses. They can lift us up in one instant to heaven and drop us in the next to perdition. And yet actually we have not moved at all. We have only actually changed the focal point of this energy vibration pattern. If we are thus able to constantly pour vibration into this reservoir, it becomes finally certain that it returns to us again as energy problem. We had noted years ago the very close relationships that exist in history and in natural history between outbursts of human destructiveness and natural cataclysms. We observe with considerable interest that apparently the planet itself can become psychically toxic. We are not sure that we understand the meaning of natural disaster. We always assume in some way that this is the final evidence of dishonesty in nature. That no matter how good we are, no matter how careful we are, who can prevent the tornado? Who can stop the tidal wave? Or who can claim any moral relationships between a community and an earthquake? It seems here that we must accept the doctrine of accidents. Yet if we wish to assume for a moment what is quite reasonable, namely that this earth and all of its parts and members may also be regarded as an entity. This earth is a rate of vibration, and from some other planet we could study its spectrum just as surely as we study the spectrums of Jupiter or Uranus or Neptune. We could thereby learn the energy that it reflects and also discover something of the energy that is inherent in it. We know that planets are sustained by the sun just as we are. But just as surely as we condition this solar energy to our own peculiar usages, so do planets. A planet as we know it today has a vast energy field of its own. The physical atmosphere corresponds to this physical energy field, and we are now considerably perturbed by this pollution of the physical atmosphere of our planet. This pollution is not so different from the pollution of the physical body of an individual. If we pour enough chemicals, enough rubbish, enough material that cannot be absorbed into the body, we will pollute it and destroy it. And if we keep on our present way, we may sometime discover that our personal habits, particularly in various forms of therapy and nutrition, may be a greater danger to us and to our survival than nuclear fission. Actually, the Earth itself begins to reveal the tremendous contaminating influence of man's own uncontrolled and unrealistic misuse of natural resources. We begin to see that our streams are polluted. The air is polluted. Gradually, the tremendous increase in population must dump its refuse into the sea or into the air or into the earth. Little by little, the physical resources of the planet are damaged. And lesser divisions, such as continents or certain areas of land, may be particularly or more immediately affected, just as we can impoverish soil by poor agricultural methods, or corrupt it by the wrong processes of fertilization. So we can destroy the productivity of a planet, of an earth, of a solar system, so far as that is concerned. On this planet, there are over 3 billion human beings whose minds and attitudes are constantly pouring thought and emotion into the vibratory magnetic field of the planet. Most of the vibration that is going into this magnetic field is about as valuable as smog. The best we can say about it is that it isn't quite as bad as it could be, but is getting worse rapidly. Into this mysterious reservoir of magnetic energy, which must also purify itself in the same way that the water and the air and the earth must purify themselves, into this energy field goes the tremendous, continual, toxic force of human negation. A world torn and confused, a world selfish and self-centered, a world warlike and dissipated, a world in which, whether we realize it or not, great units of humanity are united in common negations. Now, we may say that there are thousands of ways of being selfish, but most people practice at least a few of these ways, and the result is that a vast negative selfishness flows out into space as a rate of vibration. Of various conspiracies, the fanaticisms of peoples, the endless dissatisfactions of masses, the persecuted and the downtrodden, all these peoples simply fill space with negative energies. And these negative energies have to be in some way cleansed in order that the great nutritional field of nature be preserved. If there is too much of this, we have the same thing exactly that we have in the physical condition of mankind. If the oceans and the air and the earth cannot purify the waste that is communicated to it or dumped into it, then parts of this waste come back again in the various materials that are used for the continual survival of life. The water is a little contaminated. The air is a little contaminated. And we have to drink that water and breathe that air, and we become a little more contaminated. Then parts of this waste come back again in the various materials that are used for the continual survival of life. The water is a little contaminated. The air is a little contaminated. And we have to drink that water and breathe that air, and we become a little more contaminated. The same thing is true of our psychic natures. If the psychic field of our planet is corrupted, if the vibratory energies are polluted, then the human being who has to depend upon these energies for his own survival is receiving into himself vibratory energies that are not pure. Part of Plato's concept of the periodic eras of sterility and fertility in nature, and perhaps is the vibratory answer to the Indian, East Indian concept of the Kala Yuga. Here we have a situation in which we breathe in death, that we take in upon ourselves the final summation of the endless streams of energy that are flowing into this great final reservoir of the Earth's vital supply. If this is not kept clean, if this is not purified, if human beings do not change their own ways, they will ultimately find that this is another form of selfishness, just as suicidal as refusing to curb industries, the fumes and smog and smoke of which may endanger physical life. Nature apparently finally comes to these impasses in which forms, energy forms, vital forms, etheric forms, what we might almost call demon forms, fashioned out of the very archetypal vibratory cores that we create become like fixations or complexes within our own natures. And these archetypal negation energy patterns can, in time, produce physical phenomena. Just as surely as, for example, a gradual accumulation of mental and emotional stress within the individual may end in a stroke or a coronary, so in the earth, this gradual building up of psychic tension, psychic stress, may end in the equivalent of this ailment in the body, perhaps an earthquake, perhaps a great electric storm,
or if the corrupting influences of this psychic situation become too great, a world epidemic, and a vast plague, a pestilence, or something of that nature. We are beginning to suspect a long-range